Bless the Lord. As I was preparing for this morning, late last night, because it had completely slipped my mind, I found myself asking the question, just how many promises are there in the Bible? You know, and quick Google search, because Google is a wonderful invention, and it varies, there's estimates between 3,000 and 30,000, which is an awful lot of promises. 30,000 does seem a little bit steep when they reckon there's about 31,000 verses in the Bible. So every single verse would have to be a promise, but it could be. There was a Canadian school teacher by the name of Everett R. Storm who also had this thought and decided to spend time actually counting each and every one of these promises. It took a year and a half for him to compile a list, and his list included promises by God to man, 7,487. One man to another, 991. God the Father to God the Son, 2. And man to God, 290, plus a few other variations. But I have to ask, what is the greatest promise of God? Now, obviously, depending on who you are, your background, and all the rest of it, that may differ. But for me, I found it in Joshua 21 and verse 45. Not one word of all the good promises that the Lord has made to the house of Israel has failed. All has come to pass. Scripture affirms time and time again that God's word never fails. Even though there are times we go through seasons where we think God's not there, even when there's times that we struggle, you know, we're going through the book of Ruth at the moment. You know, we've just been hearing about Naomi and how she lost everything. She lost her sons, she lost her husband, she lost so much. You know, in our own times of darkness, we have to remember God's word doesn't fail. In times of desperation or grief, God's word never fails. We may not be seeing it right now from our vantage point, but his word never fails, you know? So this morning, as we enter into a time of worship, let us remember God's words. Let us remember God's promises. Let us remember what he has done for us. As we stand together to worship, let's remember what it says in 2 Corinthians. For all the promises of God find their yes in him. That is why it is through him that we can utter our amen to God for the glory. Amen. Amen. Let us stand and worship the Lord together. Amen.
The Lord, because his love endures forever. He is good. He is above all things. His love endures forever. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your promise that you will never leave us. You will never forsake us. You're with us always, through the valleys, through the mountains, through everything in between. Thank you that you are solid and secure. You are the rock that we can build our lives on. You are dependable and you will never, never let us go. Great is thy faith.
Thank you. washed away. So whatever fear you're carrying this morning, whatever doubts you're holding on to, whatever worries you're clinging to, let them go. Fix your eyes upon Jesus. Fix your eyes upon your Savior. The one who went to the cross for you, who bled and died and rose again, who's seated on the right hand of the Father, interceding for us. And he is here today through the Holy Spirit. Focus upon him this morning. It's cliche to say, but let go and let God. Let go of the worries. Let go of the fears. Let go of the doubts. Nothing else will do but Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just want you, Lord. Oh, Shiva.
Jesus.
Worship his name.
It is all about you. every sin that we do, Lord, is to bring you glory and honor and praise, because you are worthy of all glory and honor and praise. And this morning, Lord, we just give thanks for these offerings. Father, those that have been given here in person, those that have been given here online, Father, we ask that you would bless all of it, Lord, and that it would be used for your purposes, for your glory, for your kingdom. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. For those of you that are still standing, do you want to sit in and bless the children as they leave? The multiples of children. Exceedingly quiet. Father, we just bless them in the name of Jesus. Lord, even though they are few in number, Lord, may they just have just a mighty time in your presence today. Bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's move this out of the way. Oh. Who's eager to hear from the word of the Lord? I know I am this morning. Before I invite Pastor Rob up, I'll just point out there are people missing. You know, we're in the height of summer season. People are on holiday, but also there's people who are ill. So for those that are ill, Lord, we're going to pray for those in the moment. For those that are away, we're going to bless them in the name of Jesus, that they will encounter God just like we're encountering the Lord this morning. So, Father, we give thanks for your Son, Jesus. Lord, as we've said, it's all about him. All glory and honor and praise to him. But, Lord, for those who are not with us today, for our brothers and sisters in Christ who are hurting, they're ill, they're in pain, Lord, whether that is physical, emotional, mental, Lord, whatever it is they're going through, Lord, we ask that you would be with them today like you are with us today. Lord, that you would give them the comfort and the healing that they need today. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Pastor Rob, to you.
Good morning, church. Or half of it. What's my password? You see, it was much simpler when we just wrote things down, wasn't it? Yeah. Yes, well done. There we go. Bless the Lord. Praise God. Let me get some water. How is everybody? All right. Good. Very summery. Some summery people today. I thought I would celebrate with my all in black. To absorb some rays. Bless the Lord. Let's open our Bibles in Ruth chapter 2. Ruth chapter 2. The title of today's message is In His Hands. In His Hands. Do you know that your life is in His hands? I hope you do. Amen. We have to remind ourselves occasionally. We are in His hands. It's quite a long passage, so we're going to break this down into sections, and we'll comment on them as we go through the sections. But just before we get into the Word, let's just bow our heads one more time. Bow our hearts before the King of Glory. Father, we do just want to say thank you. Thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you, we have hope in Him. And thank you, Lord, that we are indeed in your hands. And Lord, I know, Lord, sometimes it can be difficult. Sometimes we can lose sight of that. But help us today just to be reminded, Father, through your word, Lord, of what you do, of how you take care of us, Lord, of how you are sovereign over all the aspects of our lives, Lord, all the details that you are interested in, Lord. Lord, we praise you this morning that you are indeed seated on the throne. You're worthy of all praise and glory. And we just open our hearts once more to listen to your voice, Lord, as you speak to us through the verses of Scripture. Father, in Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. So for those of you who may be joining us the first time, we've been going through Ruth. Okay, we're making good progress. We're only in chapter 2. But it's an interesting journey so far. We have heard how Naomi and her late husband Elimelech, how they moved with their sons from Bethlehem in Judah to Moab. We talked about some of the implications of that move. It all looked like the right thing to do at the time, and they didn't plan on staying very long. However, they ended up staying 10 years, and their sons Mahlon and Chilion ended up marrying two Moabitesses, Orpah and Ruth. Last week we spoke about that journey coming back to the promised land. It had all gone wrong for them, for that family. Naomi had left full, as she perceived, and was returning empty. She wasn't completely empty, as my good friend John reminded me last week, you know, in that she had Ruth. She had Ruth. And of course, above all else, she had the Lord. Though she'd lost sight of that, even though she was acknowledging him with her lips, she was really disillusioned with the things that she'd gone through and the consequences that they'd faced for that move. Anyway, she did the right thing by returning. And on that road, on the journey back, because of her discouragement, she discourages her two daughters-in-law from following her back to the promised land. And we heard how Orpah turns back and goes back to her people and her gods, to go back to the familiarity of life, the way she was living. And what shocked me was Naomi encouraged that. Go back, and says to Ruth, look, your sister's gone back to her people and her gods, a place of disobedience. And yet Naomi was so discouraged. But Ruth, she decided otherwise. She took a very brave, a very bold, courageous, wise decision. And the Bible says that she clung to her mother-in-law. Where you go, I will go. Your people are going to be my people. Your God will be my God. Praise God. And we said how that kind of represents us all as non-Jews. We're all represented in Ruth as a Moabitess because we're all engrafted into Israel's covenants. Amen. Bless the Lord. God's good. And so today, we're going to start by reading the first 7 verses, and let's listen into what the Holy Spirit wants to tell us through these verses. Ruth chapter 2, verse 1 through 7. There was a relative of Naomi's husband, a man of great wealth, of the family of Elimelech. His name was Boaz. So Ruth the Moabitess said to Naomi, please let me go to the field and glean heads of grain after him in whose sight I may find favor. And she said to her, go, my daughter. Then she left and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech. Now behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem and said to the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered him, the Lord bless you. Then Boaz said to his servant who was in charge of the reapers, whose young woman is this? So the servant who was in charge of the reapers answered and said, it is the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. And she said, please let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she came and has continued from morning until now, though she rested a little in the house. Amen. Praise God. Friends, again, the first thing that I want to say this morning, first lesson, fundamental lesson that we need to learn, is that our future is in the hands of God. Ruth's future was in the hands of God. Remember, it was a step of bold, courageous faith to leave everything that she knew in Moab, and the possibility of going back to a family and finding security again. She chose not to do that. She chose to go on a journey of faith. And that was an uncertainty to that journey. She didn't know what awaited her. She didn't know the challenges that would await. She was a Moabitess, despised by the people of Israel because of the historical problems. And yet she was willing to give up all of that and to follow Naomi and to cling to Naomi and go on that journey of faith. And we spoke about how that speaks to us all. We're all called to take steps of faith into the unknown. That's the journey of faith that we're on. It can be difficult. You don't know what's around the corner. You don't know the difficulties, the challenges. You don't know the joys and the victories. But we're called to go upon this journey of faith. It's a journey of trusting God. And we can trust Him because we know His our lives are in His hands. Just think about that for a moment this morning. Your life is in God's hands. Do you know it? Do you believe it? Well, Ruth, we see that she took her first steps of faith in a new homeland. And as she goes out into the fields to glean, and we'll talk about that shortly, we see those first steps of faith. God meets her in those first steps of faith because the Bible says she just so happened to go into Boaz's field. She just so happened to wander into Boaz's field. Hallelujah. She didn't know who Boaz was yet. The Bible says in Proverbs 16, verse 9, a man's heart plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps. You know, and I don't know about you, but there are times in my life when I can recall certain moments where God kind of reveals to you and reminds you that He is sovereign and that He's directing your steps. You may well think, you know, that all my choices are completely free and so on. We'll talk about that another time. But that God in some mysterious way is guiding our steps. A man's heart plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps. As Ruth enters the field, God providentially brings Boaz to Bethlehem. Obviously, the fields are outside of Bethlehem. So He brings him from Bethlehem. He brings him to the field. The very field where Ruth had just happened to enter to glean. Do you see? Your life is in His hands. Providence. Exactly. Providence is such a wonderful thing. It just so happens that Boaz, a wealthy man, is a close relative of Naomi's late husband, Elimelech. Wow. God's at work. He's a potential redeemer, a goel. And again, we'll talk about that later on. Our journey of faith, it might seem a little bit random at times from our perspective. And there are many unexpected twists and turns. Like I said, you don't know what lies ahead. But it is a journey that God has planned out for us. I am not saying that He is responsible for all of the bad things that happen to you. But He is sovereign. And He doesn't react. He knows. Do you follow me? God knows our steps. He knows the ways we will turn. He knows the journey that we're on. He knows where He wants to get us to. I do not understand how He mysteriously weaves His sovereignty and His providence into these choices, these journeys that we're on. But He does. Just occasionally, God reminds us of His sovereignty in our day-to-day lives. You know, when I'd first moved to Brazil, we were living with Ajana's mom and dad, and we were just about to move into an apartment. We bought an apartment, and we were at the same time we were applying for an extension on my visa to get my permanent residency, so I could stay in Brazil. And we submitted the paperwork, but on the paperwork we realized by the time the process was ended, we would have moved into the new apartment. And okay, so we put the new address of the apartment on the process and, yeah, sent off all the documents and so on. Anyway, some weeks passed by, and I remember one day I was driving from the church and I got a friend with me, and Paolo, you've met Paolo, Mom? Paolo, who used to live with us, and a very good friend with me. And we're driving along, and then I suddenly decided, I said, you know, you need to see our apartment, because he was asking about it. And I said, it's only up the way. Let's go and have a look at it. I've got the keys on me. Let's go and have a look at it. So I drove up to the apartment block, and I took him into the apartment. I'm showing around the apartment, and then suddenly a knock came to the door. And I thought, who's knocking on my door? I don't live here yet. Went and opened the door, and there was a federal policeman, a Brazilian federal policeman, who was stood there with a big bundle of documents. And he said, Robert Cooper. Yes. And he says, oh, good. And he then proceeded to explain to me that he'd been trying to track me down and was unable. I think he'd called at the address a couple of times. Of course, there was nobody there, nobody living there at that time. And he said to me, this was my final attempt. And he said, I was about to send off all of this bundle of documents that I've done the visits and to Brasilia to get their residency visas. And had you not been in today, I was going to return yours and you would have had to leave Brazil and go through the process again outside of the country. And I stood there and he says, and who's this guy? And I says, well, this is a guy from my church. He's a very good friend of mine, Paolo. He says, well, that's a good news because you needed the witness signature as well to who you are. I stood there and I thought, you know, I'm in the right place. I'm in the right place. For me, I was taking my friend to go and see an apartment. You know, we hadn't planned it, just driving down the road and then, oh, I'll take you up to the very moment that federal policeman turns up. That's when God shows you that he is in control. That's when he shows you that he's absolutely sovereign. There are so many other things. Ian's sitting at the back there. Ian, my friend Ian. Ian's been walking with me now for a while, you know, on this journey of faith. And I remember Ian one day turning up at church. I was actually going to drive past. I can't remember why, but I was going to drive past and then suddenly I drove into church or something like that. Or I parked the car and I came over to the church up at William Street, right? And there was Ian looking at the notice board of the church, and so I turned up and got talking to him, and he said, you know, he says, do you go to this church? I says, well, yes, I'm the pastor of it. And we got talking, and he asked me if we could have a Bible study at some point, you know? And it turns out that I used to go to school with his son, and Ian gave his heart to the Lord. He started coming to the church and gave his heart to the Lord, and we were able to baptize him, I think, in 2016. Yeah, 2016, and he's been with us ever since. You know, just happened to turn up at the right time, on the right day, you know. That's how God works. That's how God works. Your life is in his hands. God ensured not only that Boaz was in the right place at the right time, but, you know, God ensured that Boaz found out about what Ruth had done. In Ruth chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, it says this, and Boaz answered and said to her, it has been fully reported to me all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, and how you have left your father and your mother and the land of your birth, and have come to a people whom you did not know before. The Lord repay your work, and a full reward be given to you by the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge. Everything that Boaz needed to know, God makes sure that he knows. Where Ruth needed to be, God makes sure that she's in the right place. Where Boaz needed to be, God makes sure that Boaz is in the right place. God does not make mistakes, folks. He doesn't make mistakes. Bless the Lord. He sets the stage. He sets the stage for what is about to unfold. Hallelujah. But I want you just to think about her posture for a moment. Let's think about her posture, Ruth's posture. In verse 2, it says that she sought permission to go out into the field to glean. She had a gentle attitude of a servant. She was submissive in that she asks Naomi's permission to go. And what I see about Ruth in all of this, you know, she doesn't feel entitled to anything. She knows that what she's going to receive by grace. It's a beautiful posture of a servant heart. There's a beauty to servanthood that we need to rediscover in our churches again. There's a beauty to servanthood. She's in effect saying, you know, who am I? Who am I? As she comes into that land. What do I deserve? But she was willing to humble herself and do whatever she needed to do. There's no sense of entitlement. She makes no demands on anybody. She doesn't complain. She understood that she was there by grace. She sought grace from others. And we only seek grace from those who are superior. Again, just the heart and the attitude of a servant. A humble servant. Just wanted to serve Naomi. serve others. And so she was gleaning in the fields. And just to understand what that is, in Leviticus 23, verse 22, this was the law that spoke about the harvest. When you reap the harvest of your land, you shall not wholly reap the corners of your field. When you reap, nor shall you gather any gleaning from your harvest, you shall leave them for the poor and for the stranger. And so when harvest time came, that bountiful harvest, you know, God tells his people, you've got to still think about those who are destitute, those who are needy. So go out into your fields and reap your harvest, but make sure you leave the corners of your field for those who are poor, those who are struggling. Because I'm going to provide for them too through your bounty. I'm going to provide for them too. I love that passage, guys, because in the law of Moses, would you see something of the mercy in the heart of God? And so that's exactly what Ruth is doing. She's going out just to glean whatever's the leftovers. It's interesting that God, well, through Boaz, but I see God in all of this, you know, he starts to instruct his reapers, you know, leave some for her. Drop some for her, you know. You see the blessing, the mercy of God. But you know, when I see this for us, I think is an example of the kind of character and attitude that God is looking to develop in each one of us. It's the attitude as a follower of Christ, knowing that all is by grace. You listen to some people today within our churches, and it is, there's a sense of entitlement, do you know, and putting demands on God, and they're going to do this and do that and the other. Actually, we've said it many times, you are what you are by the grace of God. Guess what? He doesn't need you. He doesn't need me. Some of us act as though he did. You know, some of us would walk into the field, I'm here, the answer's arrived. Aren't you blessed to have me in your field? No, you're blessed to be in my field. And you're in my field by grace. That's the attitude that we need to have, folks. Praise God. Her future was in his hands, in God's hands. Secondly, her security was found in the center of God's will. Her security was found in the center of God's will. There had been a decision of faith to follow Naomi. Now there was a season of faithfulness. So it's not just about one decision to follow Naomi. God now allows her to go through a season of faithfulness. It's easy to take that bold decision, that first decision of faith. You know, well, sometimes it is. But it's that first step. But it should lead into a season of faithfulness. And God will call us into a season of faithfulness. In verse 9, praise God. Let's read verse 8 and 9. Verse 8 and 9. Then Boaz said to Ruth, "You will listen, my daughter, will you not? Do not go to glean in another field, nor go from here, but stay close by my young women. Let your eyes be on the field which they reap, and go after them. Have I not commanded the young men not to touch you? And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink from what the young men have drawn." What does he say? Verse 9, "Do not glean in another field. Keep your eyes on the field that they are harvesting. Do not glean in another field. Be faithful. Stay where I have put you. Because it's there where I'm going to meet with you. It's there where I'm going to be able to provide for you. It's there where I'm going to protect you." Praise God. Ruth had no idea of what was coming to her. He had no idea. However, it was important that she remained in the center of God's will, which was represented by that particular field at that time. Again, think about this for a moment. She enters as someone who's just gleaning. Praise God, she's going to be very different when she leaves the field. Things are going to change for her in that place. And so we need to learn from this, folks, is that we need to be faithful in the small things. Faithful in the small things. Ruth enters as somebody who will glean. She's going to leave as married to the owner. But there needs to be a season of faithfulness, a season of obedience, being obedient to what she's told to do. Zechariah 4 verse 10 says, "Who dares despise the day of small things?" Faithfulness is something, again, that we need to rediscover in our churches today. Faithfulness, because we live in a consumerist society. And even within church, you find consumerism. You know, and we're jumping around, going from one place to another. And when we've had enough of that bit of food, we'll go to another place and get another bit of food. And you understand? Faithfulness in the small things. There's a hunger. There's a desire for the bigger things of God. And we've got people who are desperate to see the bigger things of God. Praise God that there's that desire. But there are people who want to step into the bigger things of God without going through the season of faithfulness in the small things. There's people who want to buy the field before they've gleaned it, you understand? They want to be married to the owner before they've actually gleaned the field. They've gone through that season of faithfulness. Be faithful in the small things. Be obedient where God has placed you. Be obedient in the field that God has placed you in. Be a servant in the field that God has placed you in. Stay in the place of God's favor. You start to see the favor of God through Boaz on Ruth's life because she's in the right place at the right time, doing the right thing. And yet there's no spotlight on her. You know, there's no recognition by the multitudes of what she's done. The one that needs to know knows because God's let him know. Make sure that he knows. There's no stardom. Is everybody with me? Stay faithful where God has placed you. Ruth was just another one of the women who gleaned, but God had a bigger plan for her life. Praise God. When I think about faithfulness, you know, I think about one particular guy that I know very well out in Brazil. We call him Pippa. Arjun's not here. Pippa, which means kite. His name's Pippa. Do you remember him? No. No. Obviously not by the expression on your face. So, Pastor Pippa. And I remember we'd taken over a church that was closing down in the countryside of Brazil. It was about an hour and 30 minutes journey, more or less. You preached there, Pastor Paul, in Atibaia some years ago. There's a photo of Paul and I there at the church. Pastor Pippa was in his early 20s, and there were people umming and ahhing, you know, does he have the experience? You know, he's the right person to go and assume that church and try and build it up. And there was some talking around that, but we decided to release him and to send him out there to work with this church. And he went out, and I always remember, because he got his guitar always. Take his guitar with him. And he went to this little church, and it started, I used to go quite regular. There were about 10 people that had a huge, they'd been there for years, that had a huge rift, and then there were about 10 people left. And he's there with his guitar, and he's full of joy just for the opportunity to be able to work, you know, in the field. And he's playing his guitar and worshiping the Lord always. And we went and just watching him over the months and his faithfulness in the small thing that God had given him to do. He was being faithful. Do you know that that church now, they're about, I think they're up to about 800 people, and they moved out of that small building. They moved into a big factory unit as they were growing. They've moved out the factory unit and they've bought a ranch. And there is a ranch now, okay, that I'm talking like pools, swimming pools, football fields and everything. And what they do is they get all the people to come. Obviously, they have a service on a Sunday morning. And then most of the church and some of the town get together at the same place after. And they have barbecues and they spend the whole Sunday together. And you go see him today and it's like a different world. But he was faithful in the small things that were given him to do. With people doubting whether he would even, you know, be able to do what pastor that church. God knows how to exalt people in his way at the right time. Ruth entered the field as a servant. She would eventually leave married to its owner. But it wasn't just that. What does he say? Boaz said, let your eyes be on the field which they reap and go after them. Have I not commanded the young men not to touch you? Protection. Stay in the center of my field. It's in the center of God's will that we know is protection. Amen. She'd come to find refuge, the Bible says, under the wings of the Lord. And that's exactly what she was going to get. She was going to find refuge from the Lord in the field of Boaz. And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink from what the young men have drawn. What else did she find? She found provision. God says, I'm going to provide for you. Stay in the center of my will. You're going to know my protection. You're going to know my continuous provision. And it'll come from the most unlikely of places. Bless the Lord. That's where we need to be. That's where we've come. We've come to the God of Israel to find refuge under his wings. Your life is in his hands. He is your protector and your provider. But we need to stay in the center of his will. And sometimes that means sacrifice. That definitely means obedience and trusting. Amen? Finally, I want to read the rest of the chapter, verse 10. Just follow me here. Verse 10. So she fell on her face, bowed down to the ground, and said to him, why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me, since I am a foreigner? Grace, guys, right? And Boaz answered and said to her, it has been fully reported to me all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, and how you have left your father and your mother and the land of your birth, and have come to a people whom you did not know before. The Lord repay your work, and a full reward be given you by the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge. Then she said, let me find favor in your sight, my Lord, for you have comforted me and have spoken kindly to your maidservant, though I'm not like one of your maidservants. Now Boaz said to her at mealtime, come here and eat of the bread and dip your piece of bread in the vinegar. So she sat beside the reapers and he passed parched grain to her, and she ate and was satisfied and kept some back. And when she rose up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves, and do not reproach her. Also let grain from the bundles fall purposely for her. Leave it that she may glean, and do not rebuke her. So she gleaned in the field until evening, and beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. Then she took it up and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. Can you imagine? So she brought out and gave to her what she had kept back after she had been satisfied. And her mother-in-law said to her, where have you gleaned today? And where did you work? Blessed be the one who took notice of you. So she told her mother-in-law with whom she had worked and said, the man's name with whom I work today is Boaz. Remember I told you about a defining moment last week. We talked about a defining moment, yes? This is a defining moment. This is when Naomi regains hope. Praise God. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord who has not forsaken his kindness to the living and the dead. And Naomi said to her, this man is a relation of ours, one of our close relatives. Ruth, the Moabitess, said it. He also said to me, you shall stay close by my young men until they have finished all my harvest. And Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter, that you go out with with his young women, and that people do not meet you in any other field. So she stayed close by the young women of Boaz to glean until the end of barley harvest and wheat harvest, and she dwelt with her mother-in-law. Amen. The third thing that we see is that her faithfulness was honored in God's timing. Her faithfulness was honored in God's timing. Remember, people may not see your faithfulness. He does. He who knows the heart, who weighs the motives of the heart, he sees. And Boaz recognizes what's happened and he says, may the Lord repay you for your faithfulness, for your kindness. And how does the Lord repay you? With his kindness, with his goodness. Praise God. God will honor our decisions of faith, our faithfulness and obedience in due season. Galatians 6 verse 9 says, let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. The things that you are doing, the demonstration of your faithfulness and your obedience, as I said, sometimes other people don't recognize it. God does. And in his timing and in his way, he will honor that. He's a faithful God. Hallelujah. The barley harvest was upon them, so there was no time to sow, but Ruth had already sown faithfulness, and God was going to provide a harvest. In your difficult season, sow faithfulness. The one thing that you can sow is faithfulness. When it's tough and it's hard and you don't know what awaits you, the twists and the turns, the difficulties, when you're carrying pain, sow faithfulness. Sow faithfulness. The story is here to encourage us, okay, to show us how God honors faithfulness, to show us how God can change a sad story and terrible circumstances and turn the whole situation around to a great blessing. That's what it's there for. Praise God. That's encouraging. The Lord is communicating that with us. And he says, I am the Lord and I do not change. He does not change. The same God that honored her faithfulness will honor your faithfulness in due season. So faithfulness. Again, thinking about her character. There's so much we could talk about in her character. It wasn't really, I imagine she was a very beautiful woman. It wasn't merely Ruth's looks that attracted Boaz. It was the beauty of her character. It was her faithfulness. What she'd undertaken to take care of her mother-in-law. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 3 to 4 says this, do not let your adornment be merely outward, arranging the hair, wearing gold, or putting on fine apparel. Rather, let it be the hidden person of the heart, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. That is the beauty that I believe attracted Boaz. That speaks so much more than the external beauty that fades. That is the heart, that is the character that God is looking to develop in each one of us. That beautiful character of humility, that posture of humility, of servanthood, of faithfulness. The journey of faith, friends, is a journey of humility. It's a journey of learning to trust, learning to depend upon him, being faithful with that which he puts in our hands to do. Ruth, she'd gone out expecting little, yet she received much. Hallelujah. When our heart attitude is right before the Lord, he will bless us abundantly, bountifully. You know, but it's so important that we have the right posture of heart before him. Sometimes, you know, our attitudes, they can grieve God. And that's why we need to always keep our heart in check. Sometimes we grieve him by acting as though he owns us. He owes us everything. He owes us nothing. He chooses to bless us. He chooses to love us. He chooses to provide for us. He's God. Amen. We must have that heart attitude, guys. What have we learned this morning? Number one, we need to trust in God's sovereignty. Your life and your future is in his hands. It's in his hands. He sees all. He knows all. He directs our steps, though we make our plans. Number two, we learn that we need to stay in the center of God's will. That might not mean, you know, great recognition, stages, platforms, flashing lights, but just being faithful with what he has given us to do. Amen. Faithful obedience. Finally, sow faithfulness. Sow faithfulness. In the tough times, in the good times, sow faithfulness. And in due season, you will reap a harvest from God as he honors your faithfulness. Amen. Praise God. There's a lot to think about. Let's just close our eyes once more. Hallelujah. How has God applied His word to your life this morning? What has He identified in your life? As you've listened to the passages of Scripture, as you've heard the word of the Lord, how has He touched you this morning? What has He challenged you with? What has He encouraged you with? That is precious. And we need to hold on to that. Not just to be entertained, but we need to leave this place holding on to that which God has spoken into our hearts individually today. And that always invites a response. Always. How are you going to respond to what God has told us and shared with us through His word this morning? Every word that is spoken to us is like another building block in our character, in shaping us into who He wants us to be. Father, we humble ourselves before You this morning as we consider this woman of faith, a woman of beauty, not merely external, Lord, but of beautiful character, a woman of faithfulness, Lord. Lord, who provides an example to every one of us that's chosen to walk this journey of faith. And Lord, You have never promised that it would be easy. Lord, you don't reveal everything to us at once. We don't know what awaits us, Lord, very often. And we just need to keep looking up and trusting You. And Lord, as a church, as Your people will come today, Father, we thank You that we are on this journey of faith. Even at the most difficult times, Lord. Lord, we thank You that we can know that our lives are in Your hands. Our future is secure in Your hands. We thank You this morning, Father, that You are working in us. Lord, and that all things work together for the good of those that love You and are called according to Your purpose. Not necessarily what we perceive as good or feeling good. But Lord, You work all these things for the good of those that love You and are called according to Your purpose. Help us, Father, to sow faithfulness. Lord, help us to adopt the right posture of heart before You that will reap the blessing, Father, in due season. We love You, Lord. Strengthen my brothers and sisters this morning, Father. Those who are struggling, those who are finding it hard, help them, Father, to sow faithfulness, to know that we are in Your hands. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Please take this word away. Think about it throughout the coming week. Let God do His work in you, and we'll pick it up again next week.
Amen. Bless you for that, Pastor Rob. His word is faithful, and His word never fails. Could I ask Sue, could you go and let the children know that we're going to be taking communion together? So I need to be over there. My favorite time. I'd love this. I love being able to take communion with my brothers and sisters. It's such a joy. Amen. So let us just, while we're waiting for the children, let's just bow our heads, bow our hearts, close our eyes, just take a moment to give thanks for this. To take a moment to remember what God has done. As we come around this table, we're reminded of another one of the promises of God. John 14 says, Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you myself, that where I am, you may also be. Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back. He died, he rose, and he will come again. We don't know the time. We don't know the when, but we know he is coming back. That's why we take communion, to remind ourselves that he is returning. As we break the bread, just like his body was broken, as we take the juice, the wine, just as his blood was spilled, we are reminded of what he did for us, what he is doing for us, and what he will do for us. So we're going to pray. I'm going to ask Frank, Pastor Paul, if you would join me to hand out the emblems.
Oh, Lord. Father, we give thanks to your Son, Jesus. We give thanks for what he did for us upon the cross. We give thanks that his body, precious as it is, was broken for us upon the cross. We give thanks that as precious as it is, his blood was spilt for us. We give thanks for all that happened upon the cross. But also we give thanks that it didn't stop there. Jesus is no longer there. It is an empty cross. Because he died, but he rose again. And so this morning, as we take the bread and the wine, we remember that he will return. We don't know when, but we know he will. Because we remember his word is faithful and true. So, thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. So as these items come round, take them, hold them, because we're going to take them together as a family. If you are on your own today for whatever reason, then please join one of your brothers and sisters in Christ so that we can take this together.
Has everyone got who is going to take? Excellent. And so Scripture says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" The body of Christ given for you. In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The blood of Christ given for you. Amen. Amen. Frank, don't run off. Frank has a testimony he would like to give. And we like to hear testimonies, don't we? I'm not going to say. Sound men, be aware if you start singing.
I just wanted to take just 2 minutes of your time, if you don't mind. It's my birthday today, but that's not the reason I'm speaking. 3.5 years ago, I walked in here and met Pastor Rob for the first time. And he said to me what he's been telling you two for the last 2 weeks, that God had a plan for me. And I'd never been to church in my life other than funerals, christenings. Well, I can tell you now that he has got a plan for me. And one thing I do believe is I trust him, which is what Rob has been talking about for the last fortnight. And that's all I've really got to say to you. I'm now in this great place, and thanks to the Lord, and praise the Lord, and other people in this church that have helped me along the way, which includes John, Rob, Fred, Brian, and many others. My brother who isn't here today, my nephew, Joe. Thank you, everybody. God bless God.
Don't run off. Let's pray for you. Frank's been on a journey and a half, actually. He's been through quite a lot, you know, and it is an honor and a blessing to see how far he has come with the Lord. So right now, in the name of Jesus, Frank, we bless you. We bless you in the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, may you know more than ever before his abundant provision and protection over your life. Lord, let blessings overflow. Like we've heard today with Ruth. Lord, let there be more blessings than he ever expected. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Bless you, my man. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's what we love. Let's go on to some notices, which is another favorite part of mine as well. It's brilliant. Denise, I'm going to ask you to come up because you've got a couple of announcements. But before we do, threatening face. Encounter weekend. Have you paid? It is coming to the end of the month. We do have to pay the bill on Friday. And so if you have signed up for Encounter and you haven't paid your final amount, now is the time to do it, okay? Because we've got to fork out an awful lot of money for you all, and it's a blessing to be able to do it. But yeah, help out, pay your bill. Amen? Amen. Denise?
Amen. Actually, that's part of my notice. But before we get on to Encounter weekend, tonight we have our Alliance evening. Now, as you know, we pray for a different nation every single month. But I really feel we've come full circle. I really felt on my heart this month we are praying for the United Kingdom. And the Lord knows we need prayer, don't we? We need prayer. Now, I know it's hot outside, it's barbecue season, it's holiday season. I know that there are 1,000 reasons why you shouldn't be here, but there are more than 1,000 reasons why you should be here. So come along tonight, 6:30, and we will be praying for the United Kingdom. Amen. And if you think prayer meetings are boring and dull, you have not been to one of our Alliance evenings. They are anything but. Now, can I just ask, I don't want to embarrass anybody, but who's going on the Encounter weekend? Just have a show of hands. Wow, I think there are more also, aren't there, going on the, but obviously a lot of people are away. So, don't think we're doing nothing in August. We are going to be praying throughout August, starting from next week. We are going to be praying for all of you who are going on the Encounter weekend, and you are going to be praying for all of you who are going on the Encounter weekend. And we are going to be praying with fasting. I said the word. I found out that the Brazilian team who are coming over here to lead the Encounter weekend with Pastor Rob take 21 days apart before the Encounter weekend to pray and to fast so that they are in the right place with the Lord to minister. If they can do that, I'm sure we can do that to pray that we are in the right place in the Lord to receive. Are you with me? Yeah? So from next week, I'll say more next week, we are going to begin 21 days of prayer and fasting for the Encounter weekend, that you will have a real encounter with the Lord that will be life-changing. That's what it's about. It's not just a jolly, it's not a weekend away. It's to have an encounter with our God that will be life-changing. Are you up for that? Yeah? Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm looking forward to it. I'm going on the Encounter weekend. I'm so looking forward to it. I missed out last time. So, yeah, it's going to be a wonderful weekend. Pastor Rob, you had notice?
Just to say that, yes, please, give us your money. Because we've got to pay it by Friday. So, yeah, bless the Lord. Just to say that we're going to be praying for Israel on Friday night, okay? 7:00 here. You will have seen over the weekend things have gotten really difficult, and tragically a number of Jewish children have lost their lives on the Golan Heights playing football as they were attacked by Hezbollah. It looks that way. And things really do seem as though they could escalate. So we need to be praying. We need to pray. So 7:00 Friday night here, we'll be interceding for Israel and the whole situation in the Middle East. Amen.
Bless you, sir. One final notice, and then I'll release you to enjoyment of teas and coffees and biscuits, I imagine. Biscuits or cake? No cake? Just biscuits. Oh, dear, never mind. Anyway, I require volunteers. The room has gone quiet. Right, I heard a noise. That's a volunteer. Oh, dear. In August, on the 17th of August, there is an event going on called K-Fest. It's a community event. Going to be a lot of the businesses and organizations in the village are putting on something for the community to appreciate. And we are a community church. We are in the heart of the community. And so as that, we want to be involved, even if it's only in the simple way. So we need a couple of volunteers at the bare minimum so that we can open up the building for people to use the facilities, okay, just for the toileting. If we have more than a couple of volunteers, then we can provide refreshments, teas and coffees and things like that. And if we have even more volunteers, we can do even more. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. Everyone who just said amen, you've just volunteered. No, seriously though, if you want to know more, if you do feel the stirring from the Lord that, you know, you want to be involved, come and speak to me. Okay? Amen? All right, so we're going to let you go now. If you are able, do you want to just stand as we bless you before going out into the world? Amen? And so may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Go forth and be a blessing unto the nation.
Our vision is to be a worshipping community at the heart of Kings Winford,
where every home is an expression of the kingdom,
and every believer a disciple of the King.
Our mission is to be obedient to the Great Commission.
Through the faithful proclamation of the gospel.
And developing, equipping, and sending of disciples.
Welcome to Kings Winford Christian Centre.